Then I was asked to make some opening remarks on changing mindset. My mind went back to about 20 years ago when I was grappling with another concept. It is called teamwork. And a very senior colleague of mine at Bajaj Auto said something to me at that time which I remember to this day. He said to me that if you have to achieve a good teamwork, you will not do it by focusing on team and hoping that the work will become okay. But if you focus on the work and make the work okay, it is very likely that the team will also be okay. So apparently I was working at the wrong end of the problem. Many years later, I had a similar experience in dealing with the concept of family business. Because all of us who are so-called born with these spoons in the mouth, we have to at some point confront this concept called how to manage the family business. So again, somebody said to me, if you think taking care of the family will solve the problem, it will not happen. If you focus on the family, there is no guarantee that the business will be good. But if you focus on the business and the business is good, then there is every possibility the family will also be happy. So please focus on the work and focus on the business, not on the team and not on the family. Let me start with a strategic mantra that is often espoused. It is called less is more. Often I have heard people say in the context of strategy, less is more. Often when I have spoken with my colleagues, I tell them, less is more. But for a long time, I did not know what does this mean, less is more. But still, I used to say less is more. Then I read an article by one of my two favorite marketing gurus, Al Ries, and I understood a little bit about less is more when he wrote about narrow your focus. He articulated strategy as the narrowing of focus. And he went on to describe in that article how, in difficult times, instead of trying to do more, probably companies should seek to do less, to focus, to sharpen their focus. So I began to understand what less is more means. It means narrow your focus. Even more specific articulation that I think is apt to share today, I think comes from Professor Porter himself. And if I am quoting him right, this is what I read him to say. He said, the presence of strategy in a company is best indicated by what it decides not to do. Because he who decides to do everything will be the inevitable jack of all trades. And therefore, this session is about the importance of Make in India, but I have taken the liberty of calling it Make of Importance in India. Because life is too short to become a sweatshop. We don't want to become the next sweatshop of the world. We would like to make things that make money. That when you apply your mind to the choices you need to make, don't make them based on superficial possibilities. Think deeply, reflect deeply upon whatever it is that lies before you. And try to address that with a principle that will always stand you in good stead, not only for the next 6 months, but for the next 60 years. Let me present you with one such principle. Next, please. Again from Al Ries, who goes on to explain why 90% of new products and services fail. He says because they were introduced to serve a market rather than to create a market. We made the same mistake for a long time. When I joined the company in the early 90s, we were faced with a situation where somebody else was the market leader with motorcycles, a company called Hero Honda. They were very popular for their extremely fuel-efficient motorcycles, generally referred to as 100cc motorcycles. And we thought to ourselves, very intuitively that the very obvious thing for us to do was to also make something similar. And this is the marketing mistake that most of us make, and which is why we fail 90% of the time. Because we think that in order to get a slice of the pie that's out there in the marketplace, we must also go and do what the market leader is doing. What do we end up doing? All we end up doing is endorsing the market leader. All that Bajaj did through the 1990s was to imply to intending customers that Hero's doing the right thing because we are going to ape them as well. So perhaps you should go and buy their motorcycle because after all, they pioneered it. They were the original. What is important is to be contra-intuitive, to go against the tide, to go against the grain, to be different. But that takes a lot of courage. Try this in the break. Everybody is anyway using their smartphone right now, so you can go ahead and try it right now. Google the first law of motion, and it will come up. And you can do it 50 years later, and the first law of motion, i.e. in physics, remains the same. Google the second law of entropy, as in chemistry. It will come up, and it hasn't changed in 100 years. Now Google the first or second or third law of management, and your screen will go blank, because it doesn't exist. Because management is not a science. Unfortunately, management is hindsight. Management is anecdote. Management is luck by chance. And that is why we succeed only 5% of the time. So what is the job of the CEO then, as I've understood at the end of 20 years? Again, I will lean on Mr. Rees because he says it best. The job of the CEO is to find the future in the current activities. Once you differentiate yourself and create a niche for yourself in the marketplace, stay with that niche and expand from there. Too often the mistake that we then make after first success is to disengage from that center, from that niche, and try to do something that's discontinuous with it. Or try to extend our success into unrelated areas. If it's not clear, I'll make it clear with an example that everybody will agree with, I think. Kingfisher. Great success in the beverages or alcohol business. No business to get into the aviation business. And look what happens. So it's important to stay within the boundaries of your success, within the framework that created it, within that Lakshman Rekha, because that's where you are safe. Otherwise, when you step out, there is always some Ravan waiting to carry you away to Lanka.
And we are not thinking of the time when there will be driverless cars. We are not thinking of the impact on society. So do you think about the issues of urban transport in terms of quality of life and finding solutions to them and hence creating a business?
Very good question. There are a lot of theories again about the future of mobility, and if you read about them over the last 5 decades, you will see the theories change every now and then. Because as I shared with you earlier, predictions are usually not worth the paper they are written on. So I would not like to predict the future. Although I can say very clever things about electric vehicles, hybrid vehicles, hydrogen powered vehicles and blah blah blah. I think what is important is a quote of Charles Darwin. And I'm sure you're all familiar with it, but I will say it anyway. He said, "It is not the strongest nor the most intelligent of the species that survives, but the ones who are most adaptive to change." So all we need to do is to have the confidence that we can adapt. Because change is inevitable, we all know that. Now we have two choices. Either we try to predict the change. This is a very, in yogic terms, this is a very egoistic process of thinking. Ki main janta hu kal kya hone wala hai. I think this doesn't work. The more humble way to approach it would be,
I will prepare myself.
I'll be receptive.
I will be flexible. I will be listening. I will be observing. And I will prepare myself and build in myself the capability to adapt to the future. For this, I would like to share with you two personal experiences of mine. One in my personal life, about 4 years back in July 2012, I hurt my back very badly, overdoing yoga. So much so that for 3 weeks I was laid up in bed. My teacher, Guruji BKS Iyengar, he phoned me and he said to me that I heard that you are hurt. So please come to me, I will help you. But A, I was not able to even get out of bed. In fact, I could not even stand in the shower for 1 minute. There was so much pain. So there was no question of leaving the house. And secondly, Guruji had a reputation for being a very tough person. So I was rather anxious to go to him because I thought he will manipulate my body and I will not be able to stand the pain. So I didn't go to him. About 3 weeks later, he called me again. And he said, I am calling you, why you have not come to me? So I said, Guruji, I am afraid. He said, don't be afraid, come to me. So I went to him. This was around August, September 2012. And I want to tell you that Guruji made me do 2 hours of yoga, exclusively one-to-one under his supervision. He made me sit in a certain way, twist in a certain way, bend in a certain way, stretch in a certain way. In fact, towards the end, I could not believe it. He made me do a headstand, a sirsasana. He even hung a weight from my left leg because my entire left side was in pain. And he said, push against this weight while you are standing on your head. And to my surprise, I did not feel any pain throughout the two-hour class. After that, I left the class and I went very gingerly towards my car because I was in such a bad condition that getting in and out of the car, you know, articulating the body in and out of the car was very painful for me. But I found that I can just sit inside the car. I had absolutely no discomfort. Next day, Guruji called me. He said, how are you? I almost broke down. I was so emotional. I said, Guruji, I can't believe it. What no painkiller, no doctor could do. In fact, the surgeon said, definitely you need surgery for the back. But you have helped me so much in 2 hours. And he gave me this piece of wisdom, which I thought is relevant to today's session. He said, there are two ways of thinking. One way of thinking is that function follows structure. Function follows structure. He said the surgeon believes that if he fixes your structure through surgery, you will start functioning as you are supposed to function. You will start sitting correctly, standing correctly, walking correctly, bending correctly. He said, but in yoga, we believe that structure follows function. If you start functioning as you are supposed to function, do the right thing in the right way. Sit correctly with your spine up. Sit with your lower back against the back of the chair. Breathe correctly. Be aware of your movements. Do some twisting, etc. If you start functioning correctly, you will see day by day, your structure will become correct because your body is intelligent. It will adapt. And the second example I want to give you on that basis is of my company, because when Guruji said this to me, I reflected on what we had done in 2001. Until 2001, essentially, we were a company that made lots of, if I may say so, value for money or cheap products, all of which we sold in this country. And we decided that instead we want to make at least one nice motorcycle that we can sell all over the world. That is how in 2001 we launched a motorcycle called Pulsar. And I thought to myself, without knowing it, we have done exactly what Guruji was recommending. We did not first fix the structure. You know, normally we are going and fixing the technology structure, product structure, shop floor structure, distribution structure, logistics structure, organization structure, salary structure, how many structures we fiddle with in the hope that the work will happen as it is supposed to happen. But instead of that, because we decided to focus on the work, ki ek achha motorcycle banate hain jo duniya bhar mein bikega, all the rest of the structure fell into place.